Hi, thanks for joining me. My name's Tim Mitchell. I'm going to present a few short lectures regarding the Musculoskeletal Clinical Translation Framework. I'm a specialist physiotherapist from Australia, and along with some other colleagues in Perth, Western Australia, we've developed this framework to assist people with understanding and better managing people with musculoskeletal pain. The first session is titled Translating Knowledge into Clinical Practice. This slide perhaps represents me shortly after I graduated as a physiotherapist. Things seemed quite straightforward. I was very keen on what I was doing and I had a real passion for my profession. When I started treating people with musculoskeletal pain, take example back pain, there were some fairly simple, what we now call old school overarching principles. They would be someone presents with an injury. We might get them to rest initially to help that injury recover. We'd be looking at, through our assessment, working out what's wrong, and if there's pathology involved, doing scans and possibly other diagnostic procedures to try to work out what's wrong. Then we'd be doing things to help them fix that problem. And once that's recovered, they could go back to work or resume their normal activities. That seemed to work well for a fair proportion of people, but certainly in not my personal experience, not all people. That approach to managing people with musculoskeletal pain was based around a traditional pain biology approach, or perhaps an old school view of pain, where the amount of pain people had, we thought, directly correlated with the amount of damage they'd had from their injury, and that pain comes from those injured tissues, so the severity of the injury would equal the severity of the pain. We had questionnaires that would help us define how bad the problem was, and there was language used such as crippled or bedbound or exaggerating if someone presented with particularly severe symptoms. And if those people weren't getting better, we figured they had a psychosomatic problem. But again, what about that 20% that weren't recovering, that either fitted in that category or didn't fit in that category, that we really, or certainly me personally, didn't have many tools to help them out? So over the years, I went through a range of different training, and over the years, certainly the musculoskeletal physiotherapy profession has evolved. So the initial concept was certainly around manual therapy techniques and also exercise rehabilitation, but there's been a range of other approaches, including education approaches, and more cognitive or psychosocial approaches to people's musculoskeletal pain. Over that time, there's been the perspective that some of these techniques would be appropriate early on in a presentation, and the more biopsychosocial management might be more appropriate for people with persistent pain. But we now know that's not the case. The good news for people who are working in the physiotherapy or musculoskeletal pain profession is that it's a growth industry, which may not be a good news for individuals with musculoskeletal pain. This is global burden of disease data from last year around musculoskeletal conditions. So these conditions are the second largest contributor to disability worldwide, and that's consistent across countries, with low back pain being the leading single global cause of disability. And that's not just old people. So people across the life course, and particularly the working population, are significantly affected by musculoskeletal pain disorders. So 1/5 to 1/3 of people are living with a painful and disabling condition. And it's estimated with people with multi-morbidity presentations, including commonly linked with depression, that accounts for 1/3 to 1/2 of that group. And these musculoskeletal conditions impact all aspects of our life. So our mobility, our work, our capacity to improve our financial situation, and our ability to participate in many aspects of life, including social and family aspects. So this musculoskeletal pain is clearly still an important issue that we need to be more helpful or more effective in helping people with. So me originally, or my original perspective around musculoskeletal pain, now there's a whole range of other, I guess, similar versions. So a manual therapist, arguably an exercise therapist, people might call themselves a biopsychosocial therapist or a pain therapist. But each of those individual approaches, the literature really doesn't support that any of those is particularly better than others, perhaps bar exercise, but which type of exercise we're still not clear on. So another way is we have to have a broader look, or perhaps a different look, behind what's going on and also what we're doing in our efforts to assist people with musculoskeletal pain. Fortunately, we have guidelines, and there's lots of guidelines around the world. If we take, for example, osteoarthritis, and working in Australia, I'll use the latest Victorian model for osteoarthritis of the hip and knee as an example. And this was produced by project leads Professor Andrew Briggs and Miss Carolyn Page. So these models of care are helpful to guide the overarching principles, and clinical practice guidelines can give us information of what are the key things we should or shouldn't be doing in clinical practice. So a few more statistics. In Australia in 2012, the cost broadly of these musculoskeletal conditions was around $55 billion and is projected to rise on those estimates. By 2030, so in another 10 or so years' time, the number of Victorians out of the labour force or have their ability to work due to arthritis is estimated to increase, and that's by around 13% from 2015. So we're really not being effective in managing these conditions. There's a significant increase in the lifetime risk of total hip replacement and total knee replacement in Australia projected over the next 15 years. But what we do know is that osteoarthritis, at least in part, is preventable. And it's not just an inevitable part of aging purely associated with wear and tear. We know what works to effectively manage osteoarthritis and improve a person's quality of life. So we have these models of care and these clinical practice guidelines. But the problem is, despite this, effective care and accurate information aren't really consistently being provided to consumers. So as an example around this model of care, for everyone with osteoarthritis and the hip of the hip or knee, they should be receiving education and reassurance, appropriate pain management, exercise, and weight control. And as physiotherapists, we're well positioned to assist with all aspects of that initial primary care or first line care. The challenges are, broadly across musculoskeletal pain, and we just use that arthritis as an example, that there's growing evidence that does not support a number of traditional and also many more modern popular approaches for physiotherapy, except exercise. There's a lack of clear evidence regarding what does work. There's certainly inconsistent terminology and inconsistent language being used. Certainly in Australia, physios are often accused of using physio speak that they understand, or at least some of the physiotherapists do, but that doesn't translate well across other health professionals or even to their own patients. We have more information, much more knowledge, but a lot of people say we have less clarity. I know what doesn't work and what I can't do, but what can I do? Or I have these guidelines, but they're rather vague, and how does that drill down to the specifics of what I should be doing with each of my individual patients? So what's really been lacking from our perspective is this lack of a robust framework to help guide both students and clinicians in how to best manage this complex area of musculoskeletal pain. That's where this clinical translation framework was developed. So looking at those concepts of, we have current evidence, we have these models of care and clinical practice guidelines, but that doesn't necessarily translate to the clinician on the ground or in real world clinical practice. That's where this translation framework was developed. So you'll see here from these stylized pictures, this is part of our postgraduate musculoskeletal teaching team at Curtin University in Perth. So my colleagues, Dr. Darren Beals, Professor Helen Slater, and a guy you may have heard of once or twice before, Professor Peter O'Sullivan. So as a team, and also using other aspects of this postgraduate and undergraduate teaching team at Curtin University, and also broader health colleagues, not just within physiotherapy, we've developed this clinical translation framework that was really more for us than anything else to assist with consistent language and providing an easier approach to giving clear messages for physiotherapy students as they were going through training. So this is just a quick look at the first page, or the infographic, if you like, of the framework. So there's a range of components there. Just to be aware, that's not a linear process that's meant to go step by step, but this page is the best we've been able to come up with lots of iterations and feedback from different stakeholders that perhaps best represents the process without overcomplicating it, but giving due consideration to the fact that it isn't actually really simple or straightforward either. So I'll just talk through briefly the components of the framework just for clarity. And in terms of the linear approach, the first one there is first for good reason, and that's the individual's perspective. And that aligns with World Health Organization recommended approaches to understanding the person's problem. So from their perspective, how this impacts on their capacity to function and what their goals or expectations are around trying to best manage or improve with their musculoskeletal pain problem. So diagnostics important, which is internationally recognized, the triage process of determining if there are any indications of a red flag disorder, if there's clear indications for a specific diagnosis, or for more, the vast majority of what we see, those people that could be classified as having a non-specific diagnosis. Stage of the disorder is important, and it's not just a linear time course that we need to consider. And the blue boxes there representing the pain features, that's obviously an area of evolving knowledge that we're still continuing to update as more knowledge becomes available. But that best represents current understanding and accepted language around the different features of people's pain who present with a musculoskeletal pain condition. The next part is the psychosocial considerations. So people are often comfortable with the term yellow flags, but that often means to people there's something difficult or complicated going on with this person and I'm not really sure what to do. So through the framework, we break that down into three clear components: the cognitive, which is the thoughts and beliefs, the affective, which is more the mood factors, and social factors, which can encompass a whole range of different things that affect the individual depending on their personal context. Next, there's the work considerations, which obviously is highly important given depending where you work, but perhaps more than half the people you see will be at work at the time of presenting with their musculoskeletal condition. So those workplace factors are known to be very important to consider. Lifestyle factors, of course, so how that's impacting on someone's lifestyle, or conversely, how their lifestyle is impacting on their presentation of symptoms. And taking that broader view, so for general health and comorbidities that may also be impacting on their presentation. Down the bottom, we talk about someone's functional behaviours, so effectively how they're functioning or not functioning with their presenting symptoms. And we can help determine whether what they're doing at the time that we see them is either helpful or unhelpful, and what might be the key areas that we need to focus on to help assist them to manage better with their symptoms or to recover. And that overall together brings us to a point of a clinical decision-making process where we can provide at least a provisional diagnosis, have consideration for the stage of where their presentation's at, and through the framework deliver some at least good clarity around the important contributing factors for that individual. And that's where we've found this, and through feedback we found it's most helpful, that people say, I can understand what's wrong with this person and roughly where it's at, but using the framework I can now individualise some considerations of their presentation and use that in conjunction with the available clinical guidelines to provide optimised care, but on an individual basis. So let's take a typical example of someone presenting with a simple back sprain. And with this, we might think, what's that typical diagnosis and recovery process we might see? If there was delayed recovery, what would the reasons for that be, which would be arguably the contributing factors, as I've mentioned? And should our treatment differ beyond that initial first line management based on each individual's contributing factors? We have guidelines for management of low back pain. This is the most recent one that's available in Australia. And broadly what that recommends is evidence-based, simple, low-tech, but high-value care. So focus on a thorough assessment, clearly assess for pathology. So if you're a first contact practitioner, you do need to be ruling out those signs of red flag pathology. We must screen for psychosocial risk early, and obviously imaging is clearly only indicated with signs of serious pathology. Education's important, reassure, understand their pain and promote self-management. Simple analgesics, an active physical therapy approach, using a broad cognitive behavioural framework around that, and of course regular review. So checking that people are progressing if as expected. If not, why not, and what other management might need to be added. So broadly, if someone presented with simple back pain, that might, in most instances, as the literature suggests, would be a non-specific diagnosis. It might be acute or subacute, depending on how quickly they come and seek care. The most common pain type people would present with would be nociceptive pain or possibly some nociceptive inflammatory pain. Most often it would be mechanical type symptom presentation, as in a clear correlation between the stimulus, or which might be a posture or movement, and the response of the system. But we'll cover that a bit more in the next session. They might not be particularly sensitized in their tissues beyond what you'd expect for that local acute back sprain. They might have some concern about their back pain because a family member has also had back problems before that's lasted quite a period of time. So we might note that with the need for some specific education or reassurance around that. They might not have significant mood issues or social factors impacting on their presentation. Work may or may not be related to that, and lifestyle factors, once we've considered, may or may not be important. And if they're particularly healthy, then the process would be straightforwards. Usually they might present with guarded movements or some restriction of movement, which, if they've had an acute back sprain, might be helpful or protective initially, but we'd expect that to resolve fairly quickly as those initial acute symptoms settle down. Most people with an acute back sprain would have some restriction or loss of movement, so we'd consider there'd be some impairment of movement, which, as I said, would be entirely appropriate if there was a specific sprain or an incident to trigger off their initial symptoms. So in understanding that, we could implement that first line management, and we'd expect the outcome for that patient to be really positive within the expected timeframes. The issues would be if there was less, perhaps, mechanical presentation of their symptoms, if there were significant cognitive factors, so really unhelpful thoughts or beliefs or understanding about what was wrong with their back. Workplace factors might be really limiting from the job they're doing, or perhaps the work environment in terms of work colleagues could be highly relevant. There might be lifestyle factors that might be significant as well for that person that might have been assessed to be needed to be specifically addressed to ensure they recover effectively. Or they might persist with these really unhelpful protective habits over time, even after that initial tissue sensitivity has calmed down. So in those instances, using the framework to guide us, hang on, with this person, there's some other features of their presentation that requires a bit more specific targeted management or a bit more attention on early on. We find that becomes a really useful tool for students and clinicians in rationalising where they spend the time or the focus of their management. And then other things, if someone presents with broader pain behaviours, for example, that ideally would be addressed early on in their presentation to assist optimising their improvement or recovery. So that's a quick overview of the clinical translation framework of how we use it. There's the website available there if you want to check it out for more information, and there is much more detail that we've made available through an ebook that is available on the website. So hopefully that gives you a quick taste, and the following sessions will delve a little bit more into detail in some other aspects of the framework.